Good morning. So, those of you who were here Monday, I guess the majority of you may remember one of the subproblems we discussed there of the general problem of computer security was software security. So the problem there is, in short, the following. In your computer-based system, think your web shop, in the end need to have code that implements all the requests you can send to that system, right? You can send a request to put something in the shopping basket. There has to be code that implements that request. So the thing we worry about in software security is that all the code is doing? Can the code that implements put this thing in the shopping basket, can it maybe also change the price of items? Can it maybe do completely different things? Okay. At first sight, it may look ludicrous that this is possible. I mean, if I write code to put something in a shopping basket, why would it start doing different things? Yeah. Well, the sad truth is, in many cases, this is actually possible. And so the purpose of this lecture today is to explain this a bit. So the problem that makes this possible are what we call software implementation vulnerabilities, so specific classes of bugs that you can have in your code, and I'll give examples of them. Specific classes of bugs that enable specific attack techniques. So if you have this bug, somebody who can craft malicious requests, so somebody who can make a request to put something to put a negative number of things in the shopping basket, or to put many things in the shopping basket, or whatever, anybody who can craft a malicious request may be able to trigger that bug and then steer the software to do completely different things. That's the essence of the problem. And so the bugs that make this possible, we call these software implementation vulnerabilities. There are plenty of them. Evidence for that is, for example, the CVE list. So I guess some of you will know, at least have heard of this. So common vulnerabilities and exposures is a list maintained by MITRE in the US. They essentially give a unique ID, a unique identifier to any vulnerability found in widely used software. And there are about 100,000 entries on that list right now. And they're of a very varied nature. You see some of the terms here, buffer overflow, SQL injection, cross-site scripting. You have many kinds of these bugs, and I'm sure you heard about at least some of these terms, maybe not about all of them. So the point is there are really many kinds. So that's what I'll talk about today. So I have one slide added yesterday evening. I read a paper by coincidence yesterday, and so this is not in your handouts, I apologize for that, which has a bit of interesting data about this CVE list that also motivates a bit the topic that I will talk about today. So the reference to the paper is down here. I want to highlight two of the, so they give a lot of data about the vulnerabilities on that list. So one of the things they investigated is, so they looked at the 76,000 entries in the list of the last 10 years. So they didn't look at older entries on the list, so the list is bigger than that, but they just looked at these 76,000. And so one of the things they investigated is how many of them actually get exploited, because you can find a vulnerability and nobody may ever use it, right? And so they found, for instance, that there's a somewhat surprising difference between published exploits. So when a security researcher finds one of these vulnerabilities, he may write a demonstration of how to attack software by exploiting that vulnerability. It's called an exploit, a demo exploit, a proof of concept exploit. So about 10,000 of the vulnerabilities in the list have such publicly available exploit code. They also investigated by looking at data from managed security service companies how many of these exploits are actually used for malicious purposes. So which ones are used in real attacks? So not just as a demo, look, this can be exploited, but really breaking into systems, spreading malware, and so forth. And they found they could identify 4,200 of them being used in actual malicious attacks. And the surprising thing a bit is that this only half overlaps with vulnerabilities for which exploits are known. So this shows that the bad guys also build their own exploits. They don't just take techniques that people who look for vulnerabilities may have come up with. Okay. So that's one, well, I thought interesting fact of background knowledge on the danger of these vulnerabilities on the CVE list. Another interesting table, again taken from the paper. What they did is they mined the text describing all these vulnerabilities. The problem is if you have 76,000 vulnerabilities, that's a lot, right? So what are they? They're very varied. So what they did is they looked in the description text for certain groups of words, like, does it have the word remote in it? Does it have the word out of bounds memory write in it? Does it have the words code execution in it, and so forth? And then they, for vulnerabilities that have these specific word groups in them, they also count how many there are, and there are some bugs in these counts. You should divide the numbers you see here by two. I talked to the authors yesterday, there's a mistake in the paper. And they also, for vulnerabilities described by these terms, they look at how often these actually get exploited in the wild. And there, an interesting observation you can make is that all the vulnerabilities that have to do with memory management, so here, memory handling, memory corruption, buffer overflow, memory access, are on the relatively high side of being exploited commonly. Right? So there are many of them. If you look for instance, the number of vulnerabilities that have buffer overflow term in them, there's 7,000 of the 76,000, so 10%, that's significant. And they get exploited on average more often than other vulnerabilities. So that's actually what motivates the selection of the topic for the rest of the talk. So if I give a talk about software vulnerabilities, I can do it in two ways. I can either give a broad but shallow overview of the many different kinds of problems you can have. But then, of course, in 45 minutes, there is no technical detail. You can't do anything deep. Or I can focus on one specific class of vulnerabilities. So I'll choose to do the second. I will zoom into memory management vulnerabilities, but then have some technical depth. Right? If you're interested more in the other thing, if you're interested more in a broad overview of what kind of vulnerabilities do you have and what can we do about them and how do they more or less work, I recommend you to look at the software security knowledge area. That's a 20-page, 25-page document that's available on this URL. CYBOK stands for the Cybersecurity Body of Knowledge. This is all freely available information. And that document kind of gives this broad but shallow overview. Right, so if you're interested in that, I recommend you very much to look at that paper. Okay, but so let's for the remainder of the session zoom into memory management vulnerabilities. And so what are they? Well, they're relevant to software written in so-called unsafe languages. I'll explain what that means in the course of the talk, but you can think of it as C or C++ for the moment. In the talk, I will just focus on C. So it's software in a C-like language compiled to a modern von Neumann-style computer. And the fact that it's compiled to such a processor is important because the attacks will rely on the details of the compilation process. So when we describe the system model later on in more detail, we'll have to understand a bit about how software gets compiled these days. Otherwise, we can't understand the attacks. So that's the system model. What's the attacker model? So we'll assume that all the attacker can do essentially is interact with the program by giving it input and reading output. So remember what I started with, essentially you have software that processes requests and produces responses. So what the attacker can do is come up with any kind of request he can think of and send it to the code, and he can look at all the responses coming back. So the attacker does not have any specific privileges on the machine on which the software is running. He doesn't have a user account on the machine. He definitely doesn't have root privileges on that machine. So he can just interact IO-wise. We'll also assume that the attacker understands the system completely. So he knows the source code. He knows how it was compiled. He knows what processor it's running on. He knows the operating system it's running on, and so forth. He knows if an attacker doesn't know that, this is something that's typically relatively easy to find out. So, but we'll take a worst case assumption and say the attacker knows everything. Okay. And then the purpose of the lecture today will be to understand in this setting what can go wrong. Okay, and this is a setting that's been understood for a while. It's old. The oldest attacks are like 40, 50 years old. But still new attacks are being found as we speak. So what I'll do is I'll explain one attack in detail and then give you an overview of the kind of the space of attacks that is there. But maybe before we start, it makes sense to kind of get an understanding of how well you know this already. So this is a very famous example exploitable program. It's taken from Gera's insecure programming exercises, kind of training material to learn about buffer overflows. It's nice because it kind of shows the effect of a buffer overflow in the simplest possible setting, essentially. So what you see in this program, So it's just a simple main function that declares two local variables, an integer cookie and a string, a character array with 80 characters called buffer, buff. It prints some information about these variables. This is not important for the moment. It will help us exploit it. But essentially what it does, it prints the addresses of where these variables are in memory. And then what this does is it will read from standard input. So this is input that might potentially come from the attacker. It will read characters from standard input until a new line is pressed, and will put the characters read into this buffer, right? And then it will do a test on this local variable, check whether it's equal to this weird big hexadecimal number, and prints out you win when it does. The question about this program is, how do you make it print out you win? What do you have to do as an attacker to make it print out you win? I'm sure many of you, at least some of you, have seen this example before. So who immediately sees what input to provide to this program to make it print you win? Okay, 4 or 5 people. For those of you who haven't seen it, let me show you, because I think it's interesting to understand this very simple example deeply, because it's really the essence of what can go wrong. So to understand, the first point is, of course, you would never expect this to happen, right? Because you declare a local variable, you assign it 0, you never do anything with it, and then you test whether it's some weird number. So this test should always fail, right? That's what you would expect. The program has a memory management vulnerability, and as a consequence, what you expect will not hold, and that's actually the essence of these vulnerabilities. So to understand why this might actually be printed anyway, you need to understand two things. So the first thing is, of course, all these local variables, they have to be in memory somewhere, right? The compiler has to store them somewhere. And where they're stored will depend on details of the compiler, operating system, and so forth. But let's assume for now that they're put in memory next to each other. So we have the cookie here. And we have a bigger, so this is 4 bytes on a 32-bit machine, and we have the buffer, which is 80 bytes next to it. Right? That's the first thing. So some compilers will do that. Some others won't, but some compilers will do it. Let's assume that the compiler does that. The second thing you have to understand is that this thing that reads input doesn't check bounds of the buffer that it's writing data into. So while it's reading characters, it will fill up this buffer. And if the attacker keeps typing and never puts a new line, this input will actually be stored higher and higher in memory, possibly overriding the memory allocated to this cookie. And that's, of course, the trick that you have to do to attack this program. So by typing more than 80 characters, you will start changing the 0 that was here. And then you have to figure out exactly which characters to type, and that will depend on whether it's an ASCII or an EPIC machine, or whether it's a little endian or a big endian machine, and how much space there is between these two variables and so forth. Many details you have to get right, but that's the essential idea. Okay, does everybody get that? It's very simple. So the next step is, if I change the program to be this one. So it's exactly the same program, I just removed this if statement. And now again, the question is, what input should I give the program to make this print out you win? Again, I'm sure some of you see that. How many of you know how to make the program print out you win now? Only a couple. So that's actually, okay. Okay, I know. So I'll let you do it live. this is a second key point. So, okay, you can do weird stuff with exploiting memory management vulnerabilities, but you can still kind of expect this, right? The program has this statement in there, so we can trick the program to execute it. This program doesn't even have any printf you win in there. So how do you make it do the point is, you can, and I'll explain you how. And that's the danger of these software implementation vulnerabilities. These are bugs that enable specific attack techniques that allow you to make a program do something completely different, right? And memory management vulnerabilities are a very important class. On Monday, I gave the example of a SQL injection vulnerability, which is similar. You can also make a SQL query do something completely different than what you expect. Okay? Okay. So we're ready to dive into the details now. So I'll first go describe the system model. So I'll describe how C gets compiled, essentially. I'll go quickly over that. I'll assume you have a background in computer architecture or operating systems or a bit of compilers. I'll go quickly, but don't hesitate to ask questions or stop me if something, if you missed something. I'd rather you are with me than that I just waltz through this stuff. Once we understand the system model, I'll explain one attack in detail and then give you an overview of the full spectrum of attacks. Then we'll look at one mitigation technique and an overview of other mitigation techniques. And finally, if time, we'll look at how to avoid having these vulnerabilities in your code in the first place. Right? So software implementation vulnerabilities, the attacks we'll talk about today, are only dangerous if you have bugs in your code. So the easy thing is to write your code without bugs. Well, it's not easy, but it's a solution. Okay, system model. So, as I said, it's the system we worry about is a C program compiled to run on a von Neumann-style processor. I'll essentially think of GCC on Linux on x86. Right? That's where I'll build my examples using that compiler, operating system, processor chain in mind. The details of the attacks I'll talk about will be different on other systems, but they will work on all these other systems too. As long as you have a von Neumann-style processor and C compiled to it efficiently, the attacks will work, but the details will differ. So I'll make some choices in how the compiler and the operating system and so forth works, but they're not essential. That's the point I want to make. So what does the processor look like? As you would expect, so the processor has byte addressable memory, say from 0 to 2 to the n minus 1 typically. That could be either virtual memory, so it could be a user level process on an operating system, or it could be physical memory. It could be that you're using C to program an embedded device, and there's no operating system, you're just directly using physical memory. Attacks work in either scenario, so we don't care about this. We'll just talk about memory. And then we'll have a CPU, with registers that you would expect, at least a program counter or an instruction pointer, whatever you want to call it, a stack pointer. I'll come back to how the stack works in a bit more detail in a minute. A typical instruction set with to do arithmetic, logic instructions, memory loads and stores, branches, conditional branches, and so forth. And important, instructions, that's what a von Neumann-style computer is, stored program computer, instructions are stored in memory also as data. So in that memory, you have intermingled data of the program and code of the program. The machine code of the program itself is represented as bytes in that memory that I mentioned here. So the main actor that decides how data and code is organized in memory is the compiler. And here is more or less, here is a high-level overview of how the compiler does that. So first, the compiler will, of course, translate all the C functions that you write into machine code. And I'm not going to talk about the details of how to do that. I assume you believe me that this is possible. He generates per function a blob of machine code, and all that machine code is put next to each other in what is called the code section, and in GCC on Linux, it's at the bottom of memory. Okay, so that's this code section here, a bit more detail about it later. So functions are compiled separately, so we need to do something to track the control flow through the program. When function F calls G, G calls H, then when H returns, we know we have to return to G, and then when G returns, we know we have to return to F. We need to track that somehow. That's tracked in a data structure called the call stack, at top of memory, that essentially has what is called an activation record per active function. And one of the things that activation record contains is where we should return to after this function has completed. And I'll look in a bit more detail again in what is more in the call stack in a minute. Where is data? Well, that depends on what kind of data we're talking about. In a C program, you have different kinds of mutable variables. You can have global variables, you can have local variables, you can malloc stuff, you can do new in C++ to allocate stuff. So local variables are allocated on the call stack. I'll explain why when we discuss the call stack in a minute. For global variables that live for the entire lifetime of the program, there's a separate section in memory, the data section, where all the global variables will live. And for dynamically allocated storage, so when the program asks for new storage using new or using malloc at execution time, that's done with the help of a memory management library that manages a chunk of memory called the heap. So, for instance, in C, you will have malloc and free. If you call malloc, you get a piece of memory here, you can use it, and when you're done using it, you call free, and it goes back to the pool and can be allocated to somebody else. Okay? Important also to understand that axis pointers in C will be just represented as integer addresses. So when you call malloc, you'll get a pointer to a chunk of memory you can use, and that will just be an address somewhere in the heap. And you can do pointer arithmetic in C, so you can move that pointer upward by just adding to it. And actually, arrays are just very much like pointers. You can think of an array as a pointer to the first element. And array indexing is then also just adding, is pointer arithmetic essentially. To access the nth element, you add n to the base pointer to get to an essentially. Okay, again, stop me if I say something you disagree with or you don't understand, don't hesitate to raise your hand. So here's an example. If you would run this program, this has a global variable, a local variable, and some dynamically allocated storage. And if you print out the addresses, you would see that they are indeed in these different memory areas. And you see, you can also ask, where is the code of main located? You can take the address of a function, and you would see that the value printed out here will be somewhere low in memory in the code section. If you do this on GCC, on Linux, on x86. Okay, a bit more detail. Oh, this is this readable? I'll try to remember to say what is there. I apologize for that, if it's important. So the code section, a little bit more detail. So I said it's just a chunk of every function in the program, both in your program as well as in the libraries. There will be machine code for that function somewhere in memory. For instance, here is the machine code for main, here is the machine code for malloc and free, and so forth. Right? Now, the structure of that code is always the same. It starts with a prologue. And the purpose of the prologue is to allocate space on the stack for this function invocation. Remember, on the stack we'll have an activation record that has all the data relevant for this particular function invocation. And that stack record is allocated by code that's in the prologue of the function. I'll walk through an example on the next slide. Then we have the actual code for the body that does the computations that you have in the C program. And then in the epilogue, there is a bit of code that puts the result in a designated register, for instance, and that removes the activation record again. So we see that as we call functions, activation records will pile up on the stack, and as we return, they will pop off again. So let's look in a bit more detail at what's in these activation records. So there is all the information necessary for one specific invocation of a function. So that's at least the actual parameters. When you call a function many times, you'll call it with different parameters. So that's invocation-specific information. Where the function should return after it finishes, the return address. And space for all the local variables. Every invocation of the function gets its own local variables. So that's why it makes sense to put these in an activation record too. Okay, so let's look at an example. Here it's more annoying that this is not readable. So let me remind you to call out to what is in that picture when necessary. So what you see here is memory. This is the top part of memory where we have the call stack. This is the bottom part of memory where we have the code, and I just put them next to each other to fit on the slide. We see here code for machine code for functions. So here is code other functions, and I highlight the two specific functions, F1 here and F0 here. And the program currently is in a state where it's executing in F0. The program counter is somewhere within the range of the machine code of function F0. Right? And so that also means that at this state, the top level of the stack, the top activation record on the stack, is an activation record for F0. And we see parameters for one particular invocation of F0, a return address, and local variables. On GCC, on Linux, on x86, also manages a frame pointer that I'll not talk about. We won't need it for the attack I'll talk about today. It's used to more easily access the local variables. It's an additional process register that gets stored and saved, but you can ignore it. Okay, so let's see what happens when F0 calls F1. So we are here exactly at the place, so addresses go up, so execution also goes up. We are here exactly at the point where F0 will call F1. So the first thing it will do is the compiled code will push all the actual parameters for the invocation of F1 on the stack. And we see them appear here. So as we execute this pushing of parameters, the parameters will occur here on the stack. Then we have a machine code call instruction. What that does is it will push a return address, the address of the next instruction on the stack, Okay, so this will point here. And the program counter will go to the address F1. We're calling F1. Okay. Now the prologue of F1 will execute, and that will allocate the stack record. So we'll save the frame pointer and set the frame pointer again. I'll gloss over that. And we allocate room for local variables. So the compiler knows, of course, how many local variables F1 has and can allocate, can inject code in the prologue to allocate enough space for them. Okay, then the F1 executes, and then the epilogue comes, which will pop the stack record, and the return will pop the return address, and the program counter will go to where the return address points. Okay, and then there should here be additional code that I don't have on the slide to pop these parameters. And then we can continue the execution of F0. Does that make sense? That's all we need to understand to understand all the attacks. In the slides, I'm not going to go into this. You have a snapshot of an actual dump of memory on Linux that you can now try to figure out what it all means, right? So by understanding how the compiler works, what you can do as an attacker is take a binary dump of memory and then try to figure out, okay, what is this program doing? Where is it? Where is the stack pointer? And understanding that is an important prerequisite to be able to do exploits. Okay, so that's the system model. So now, what are the vulnerabilities we worry about? Well, we saw examples of them. So more generally, a vulnerability is if you use memory, a memory management vulnerability is if you use memory in a bad way. So what does that mean? C has a number of ways to allocate storage. We've seen that we have local variables, global variables, we have malloc. Also has a number of ways of accessing that memory. You can access it just using a variable name, you can access it through a pointer, you can access it as an array, and so forth. Now, unfortunately, the using these memory allocation, deallocation, and access operations, you have to do that correctly. There are many ways in which you can do that in an incorrect way. For example, if you allocate 100 bytes and then try to, if you allocate an array of 100 elements and try to access element 101, clearly that's a bug. If you allocate memory, use it, deallocate it, and then use it again, clearly that's a bug, right? So memory management vulnerabilities is any kind of vulnerability where you don't satisfy the contract, essentially, of the memory management functions that C offers. You have to use allocation, deallocation, and access in specific ways, and if you do that incorrectly, you have a memory management vulnerability. And the bad thing is, why C is bad, why this is mainly relevant for C, and so that's what we call unsafe languages, is that C will make the programmer responsible for avoiding these bugs. So it's up to you as a programmer to make sure you don't have these bugs, that you use memory management correctly. Otherwise, what the C language specification says is, whatever happens now is undefined. The compiler can actually do whatever it wants, and actually will do stuff just to make sure things can be performant. Okay, and so that's why these vulnerabilities are so dangerous in C. Undefined means anything can happen, means instead of putting something in the shopping basket, maybe somebody sets the prices of all items to zero. Anything can happen, it's undefined, right? And so the trick of attacks, the key idea of attacks is now, as an attacker, what you will do is you will figure out input to the program to trigger one of these vulnerabilities. If the program has one of these memory management vulnerabilities, we look for input to trigger that. We want the program to run into the bug. So then further behavior of the program is undefined. But from the point of, so what will happen actually is that depends on how the compiler worked, right? And so the trick of the attacker is to fully understand how the compiler works to make sure that what happens is something that's useful for the attacker. That's the essence of the idea of exploiting memory management vulnerabilities. So you try to turn this undefined behavior at the specification level into, it'll do whatever I want it to do. That's the basic idea. Okay, so let's look at one example attack scenario. So this is the oldest and simplest, in a sense, full power attack scenario. This is called the stack-based buffer overflow or call stack smashing or whatever. I explained to you how the stack works exactly to be able to explain this attack technique. So we saw when we discussed the stack that on stack records you have all kinds of stuff intermingled, right? You have local variables as well as parameters, return addresses. So if one of these local variables, for example, is an array that can be overflown, we might be able to mess around with the memory in the neighborhood of that local variable, and there is actually a lot of interesting stuff to mess with. That's why stack-based buffers are interesting to overflow. So let's see how this works. Here we have exactly the same scenario as we saw on the previous slide. So we have F0 calling F1, but now F1 will have a buffer local variable and a vulnerability in its body. This is vulnerability, which will overflow the buffer. For example, it may have this gets function that you saw in the beginning on the buffer. So it may actually allow the attacker to write past the buffer as far as he wants. So what will happen is parameters to F1 are pushed on. The call instruction happens, return address is pushed on, the prologue is executed, which will allocate space for variables, including the buffer I mentioned. So the buffer will be somewhere here. And now vulnerable code comes. So now, for example, we're getting input from the attacker and storing it in this buffer without checking the bounds. So that gives the attacker the power to overwrite his memory, starting from here, going upward. So there's all kinds of interesting stuff an attacker can do. All these things could be changed by an attacker. We'll pick one thing. What he'll do is overwrite this return address. Why? Because this indicates where the execution will continue after this function is done. When this return gets executed, the address that is here will be where the processor continues. So if we change that, we change what the program will do. So where do we change? What do we change it to? Well, we'll change it to an address that points into the data that we as an attacker put into the system. Why? Because now, when the processor jumps here later on, what is here is stuff that we chose as an attacker. So this is machine code that we chose. So that's how we can make a program do anything we want. Essentially, we make it jump to a place where we put code that we have chosen, so essentially we can make it do anything you want. Right? So you see it happen here. So on the epilogue, the compiler will adjust the stack pointer a bit. On the return, it will take this address and jump to it. So you'll see the program counter jump over here. And now it starts executing code that we have chosen. And this is, for example, how you would exploit the second example I gave in the beginning of the talk. You can have code here that prints "you win." Of course, in practice, you might want to do something more interesting, but I think you see the point. Okay, so that's kind of an old and basic attack that I guess many of you know. So the third dangerous thing, so it's not only that you can make a program do whatever you want. The bad thing is you can make it do whatever you want in a multitude of ways. And I want to show that by showing a structured overview of a text that I've taken from this paper, a systematization of knowledge paper published at Oakland a couple of years back. So here is the picture. So this graph essentially shows the different ways in which you can exploit a memory management vulnerability. And I'm not going to go through all the details. I just want to show, for example, the attack we just did. What we did is we made a pointer go out of bounds. We made this pointer that was filling up the buffer go out of bounds, using it to write, to modify a code pointer, to point to the address of our own code, or shell code, using the pointer that is used by the return instruction, essentially the return address, to execute injected shell code. It's called the control flow hijack attack. So that's the path we followed with this example attack I've shown you. But the point is, any path through this graph gives you another attack. And you have even loops in here, which gives you an infinite number of ways to do these attacks. So let's look at, for example, Heartbleed. So I guess some of you have heard about Heartbleed. Heartbleed was a trick to read out memory of a web server. Essentially, Heartbleed in this graph is make a pointer go out of bounds, use it to read, output, so the program will be outputting what the out-of-bound pointer is pointing to, and that leads to an information leak. So Heartbleed is that path through the graph, right? The very first example we did, where we changed the cookie, is called the data-only attack. What we do is we make a pointer go out of bounds to write, to modify a data variable to something we choose. In this case, we had to pick this 4142 whatever value. Where the program will use the corrupted data variable, in our case in the if statement, to then do something that was not intended to happen. This is called a data-only attack because we're only messing with data and not with control flow of the program. And so the loop here is, you can use this trick of changing something in memory to make another pointer somewhere else in the program go out of bounds and do the same thing all again. That's called an indirect pointer override attack. And so, well, the point I want to make is, don't be fooled into thinking that, oh yeah, okay, now that I understand this attack, it's relatively simple to solve. It's not. I mean, we've seen for 40 years, people have been trying to fix stuff, and new attacks have been found, and so this is something that has been going on. It's still the number one concern of big software companies. I spoke to a Microsoft engineer 2 or 3 months back, who confirmed that memory safety, so dealing with memory corruption vulnerabilities, is still their number one concern. And the information I gave you about CVE earlier in the talk confirms that too. Okay. So then, what can we do about it? And there are two kinds of things we can do. One thing we can do is we keep the bugs in the program. It's undoable to fix bugs. On average, big programs will always have bugs, about 2 bugs per 100 lines of code for well-engineered code. So we can't solve these. So what we'll do is we'll harden the compiler, the operating system, the processor, such that the anything can happen becomes less dramatic. That's the idea of mitigating attacks. And this is something that, again, people have been working on for many years. And actually, this picture and the paper, and I'm not going to go into that, also discusses how the various defenses, various mitigations, deal with different phases of the attacks. What I'll do is I'll show you a very simple attack, a very simple mitigation that deals with the attack that I've shown you. But then again, I point you to the paper, the Oakland paper, for an overview of the many, many defenses that have been proposed over the past years. So a very simple mitigation is so-called stack canaries. Again, I'm sure some of you have heard about that. So stack canaries are a mechanism to protect the integrity of the return address, so to protect the integrity of a certain part of the activation record. The basic idea is, here you see it on a picture, that the compiler will, in the activation record, so in the prologue code of a function that creates the activation record, there will be a bit of extra code to put a canary value here. What is a canary value? It's a value, for example, that cannot be predicted by the attacker, say a random value. Right? And what we'll do is we'll put this here in the prologue, and we'll check that it's still the same value in the epilogue. And if it's not the same value, we crash. Program stops. And so we can see that works. So again, we walk again through the attack. We push parameters. We call F1. The prologue allocates the stack frame, which now also has its own canary. We trigger the vulnerability, so there'll be an overflow here. Right? We can still change the return address. That works, but we can't get to the return address without also overwriting the canary. And we don't know what to write here. It's a random value. So likely, very high likelihood, this will have changed. And in the epilogue code, there's a check for that. So the change will be detected and the program will be stopped instead of starting to execute attacker code. Very simple mitigation, very cheap, almost no memory cost, very small performance overhead, and it stops the attack mentioned. The problem is that, and I had an exercise on that, but I'm going to skip it because of lack of time. All these efficient attacks, all these efficient mitigations are also always bypassable. So we are in this dilemma that we know how to solve this completely. We know how to make memory safe C compilers. But the performance cost of these compilers is high. It's 80% or more of performance cost. So people don't want to pay that price. So they look for cheaper countermeasures. And all the cheaper countermeasures, and many of them, I'm sure you've heard about non-executable data, about address space layout randomization, about control flow integrity, and so forth, all these countermeasures have been bypassed. I think we're at a point where I think the research community is agreeing that we should give up on this race and just pay the performance price. And actually, hardware vendors are putting hardware instructions in their processors in order to be able to do this more efficiently. Intel tried this the first time with Intel MPX. It wasn't done very well. They'll try it the second time later. And eventually, it'll work. Eventually, I think we'll see this phase out. But, well, people have been predicting this for a while, too, and it hasn't happened yet. So the next thing you can do, instead of mitigating the attacks, is try to get rid of the vulnerabilities. And then the question is, what are the vulnerabilities exactly? So we've only seen actually buffer overflows. So, as I said, anything that violates the memory management contract, so whenever you access memory that according to the way in which you allocated it, you should not be doing, then that's a vulnerability. And you have different kinds of them. So the simplest one, and it's the only one we've seen, is a spatial vulnerability. So this is, you allocate a buffer and you access it out of bounds. So you can do that by indexing an array out of bounds, so you can do it with pointer arithmetic or whatever. That's called a spatial vulnerability. You allocate something and then you access it out of bounds. A temporal vulnerability is you allocate something, you use it, then you deallocate it and you keep using it. So you use it at a point in time where you're not allowed to use it anymore. That's called a temporal vulnerability. Yet another less common kind of vulnerability is pointer forging. So if the program at some point is stupid enough to construct a pointer, let's say from an integer, and the attacker can influence that integer, then that pointer that is constructed, if you dereference it, clearly will be an invalid memory access. So that's another example. And finally, this is more important than the third. C also has a way of calling functions with a variable number of arguments. If you can succeed in confusing the function such that it thinks it has less arguments or more arguments than it's actually been provided in the program, that's also a bug. That's also and that also leads to invalid memory accesses that can actually be exploited. Okay. So how do you get all these vulnerabilities out of your code? There are a number of ways to do that. Of course, you can prevent them from ever entering your code. Use of another language is one way of doing that. So if you use a language that specifies that either the compiler should statically check for these errors or should emit code that detects these errors at runtime, like Java does, like Rust does, like Python does, like many languages do, then you have to worry less about these issues. They may still occur in native libraries that you link with, but at least the code you write will be fine, right? Another alternative is, if you have to stick with C, maybe for performance purposes, is to follow coding guidelines. So there are entire books that tell you how to write code in a clean way in C, such that you are less likely to make these kinds of mistakes, and you're less likely to have these bugs. If you already have code, and you have to find the vulnerabilities that are in there, there are many ways to detect them. Obviously, code review, still a very important. So having somebody else read the code and try to understand what happens is a good way to find bugs in general, also memory management vulnerabilities. There's a lot of tool support for that. So you have static analysis tools that will scan your code, and these range from very simple tools that, for example, will just look, are you using a dangerous function like gets somewhere? And that's all they do, that's very simple. Up to very complex tools that will prove that the program, so using mathematics, will prove that the program never performs in any possible execution for any possible input, will never perform an invalid memory access. So these tools are very simple and easy to use and quick to use, but they give you a bit of assurance, a very little bit. These tools are expensive to use. They take a lot of time from the programmer. The programmer has to help the tool to construct the proof, but they give you very strong assurance. That you don't have that you kind of weeded out all the bugs. And finally, and I guess this is probably the most widely used approach in practice, you can test for the presence of these vulnerabilities. A very common technique is fuzz testing. So the idea of throwing crap at the program and trying to make it crash, for example. You have smarter ways of doing that, so you can try to create the crap in a smarter way so that you cover more parts in the program. And of course, you have to make sure that the program is instrumented, will actually crash whenever you do an invalid memory access. And there are so-called sanitizers that help you do that. For example, address sanitizer will do that for memory safety vulnerabilities. And so this is the most practical way to detect and remove these vulnerabilities for your code today. Okay, so let me finish there. I have 1 minute left. So I hope I convinced you of the importance of software implementation vulnerabilities in general and memory management vulnerabilities in particular. And in particular, the area of memory management vulnerabilities shows this very clear, this attacker-defender race, like the many different attack techniques that have been developed and many different defenses that have been developed that overtake each other in the course of time. So the main evil doer here is the desire for performance. We see that often in security, but we want to make things go fast, and for that we cut corners, and this is essentially one of the reasons of why we have had so many problems with security For the C programming language. But there are some promising things on the horizon. I mentioned this hardware support to safely and efficiently compile C. I mentioned safe programming languages. So who has heard about the Rust programming language? Okay, oh, look at that, more than half. So this is a programming language really designed to be a safe replacement for C. Right. It doesn't have a garbage collector, so it tries to be as efficient as C, but it has a strong type system and it will emit runtime checks in cases controllable by the programmer. You can also do unsafe things if you want, but at least you're much more controlled than you are in C. So maybe these things will help us get rid of at least this class of vulnerabilities. Okay, I think that my time is up. I'm happy to answer any kind of questions you might have.